as a chairman of the Royal Photographic Holography Group, I wanted to welcome you and also to tell you a little about why 2008 is an interesting year, because it marks the 60th anniversary of holography, that then the way Dennis Gabor introduced it, the inline holography for microscopy. And then, of course, so that is extremely important. And then, of course, after the 60s, when lasers came about and we could make holograms with lasers, the whole world will know about holography, but not really until then. The other anniversary is the Nobel Prize in Photography in 2008, given to Professor Gabriel Lippmann, who invented color photography. Still the best form of color photography ever achieved. And that is, of course, something that most photographers have not even heard about, nor have they seen a Lippmann photograph. And when I talk about that is how the important photography is for museums. When black and white photography came about, the museum started to use black and white photography to make photographs of artifacts or of pyramids and other things for the rest of the world, then if they never could travel there. And that then changed, of course, when color photography came in about, they could make beautiful reproduction of a lot of things, like paintings, other artifacts and whatever that you want to show to the rest of the world without having to travel everywhere. With holography now, we have actually got the possibility not even reproduce anything, we can actually show it the way it is without having the object there. What we can do now when we introduce color holography, we go from a possibility to record a field of light that is emitted from an object, store that, and then replay that forever without having to have the object there. And when you go to a museum, most of the artifacts you are not allowed to touch, or they even are put very often behind glass. So why do you really need to have something behind glass when you can give the same effect by just looking at the image of it, like look identical to the object? The same goes with paintings. Oil paintings, for example, are now often protected with a piece of glass so people don't come and spray paint on them. And that means, of course, that why do we need to have a painting behind the glass when we can have exactly the same sensation by the hologram of the painting? And, of course, this looks a little strange to people in museum, but photography looked strange, everything looked strange in the beginning, but sooner or later, museums will take advantage of it. And what I'm going to show now is where we stay today. We are not really there yet, but we are on the way. So within 5-10 years, I think we will have techniques that are absolutely amazing. Okay, so let me start with my first slide. What I'm going to talk about, I can also tell you, you don't know me, I work at OpTIC Technium in North Wales. There we have a Center for Modern Optics there where we develop material, we develop full color holography and also holographic optical elements, full color, and a variety of other optics related techniques. And OpTIC Technium in itself is a interesting building which was actually set up to develop, create new companies in optics, an incubator. It's not like a university, it's a research and development center to create new business in optics. Anyhow, so, and we are also part of the Bjelkhagen University in Wrexham. So, are you operating the slides? Okay. So this is OpTIC Technium in Wales, and this building is from, it's covered, the whole front here is covered with solar panels for your for photovoltaic. This is the largest area in Europe just now. Okay. Now let's go to holography, and particularly for museums. So during Art Emmett Leith, when he introduced his first hologram in April 1964 of the train, the toy train, he got the whole world got extremely amazing And then after that, a lot of developments went on in holography to develop these techniques, including display, of course, that one we are focused on today. And then a lot of other applications came, like interferometry and optical element, computer-generated holograms, and a lot. But let's focus now on display today only. So during these years, from that time until, I would say, 2000 or so, there have been some, very, very few, actually, examples of holograms used in museums. All these holograms have only been made with one laser so far, and that means you can only record monochrome holograms, although you can tune them to different colors. But there was the main practice, and museums, of course, today in the world of color, where you have color TV, movies, everything is in color, and come with a 3D technique without color, didn't appeal to museums. So that means that we had to wait until, and that's where we are today, so we don't know what will happen in museum, but at least we have a chance now to get the interest from museum. And what I'm going to show some during that time, what I have done, some of the more interesting ones I have done since 1969, when I started in holography. Okay, the first thing I did was in 1974, in Sweden. I worked in Sweden, I am from Sweden, so I started that. I did the crown of Eric the 14th. They had a stamp exhibition, Stockholmia 74, and they had made these stamps of the crown. And of course they couldn't move the crown out to this exhibition, so they asked me to make a hologram of the crown and show it at the exhibition there. So if you go to the next slide, there you can see me recording the crown in the cellar of the castle, August the 20th, during the night we were doing it. And this, of course, is again monochrome hologram, and this is actually the first type of hologram, off-axis transmission holograms, that need lasers or mercury lamps to reconstruct them, to show them at an exhibition. We spent a lot of work on that, and it was one of the most important things for people. They had never had so many people coming to a stamp exhibition. They didn't come for the stamp, they came for this hologram. So you can see the exhibition now at the exhibition there in 74. Next slide, please. So here is a cabinet that they made. There is a hologram, and of course in this case we used a mercury arc lamp with a yellow filter to make it go. So it looks rather good here, as you can see, but of course the lack of the rubies and so in the crown doesn't show. Nevertheless, it was the first time Swedish people saw a hologram at all, so it was very successful. Next slide, please. The other thing is, which is again something that now is important for museum, is the possibility to, in local museums, to show things that they can't because the National Museum may want to have it. So a gold collar was found in a river in Sweden in 1827. It's from about 500 AD. And it is kept at the Museum of National Antiquities in Stockholm. But the local museum wanted to also show it, so the only way they could do it was to order a hologram to show it. Next slide, please. Here you can see the hologram, again a gold tune. This is a reflection hologram now. And that was done by Holovision in Stockholm, the company I was running when I was in Sweden. This was done in 1980. And the museum was Falbygden's museum, where they found in that area this gold collar. Next slide, please. And this you can see the installation we did at the museum. So here is a hologram and explain what it is. It has, these holograms should really be done with like 45 degree tilt, and the spotlight should be just above, straight down, like that. Then nobody will see the spotlight, nor would they realize that there is any particular strange with this. It's just the object is there in a little box, like the other things you see here. And of course, that at that time, that was the best we could do. The next best to the real thing. Now, of course, color holography has completely changed this. Next slide, please. Okay, let's go now to recording of color holograms. The problem, we don't see much holograms. There are only a few people in the world, and today we actually have one of these people here as well, a few from Russia, but also Yves Chantet, who has been working hard on this for the last 10 years. Anyhow, what we need is panchromatic materials. That's something you can't go out and buy. They don't exist with the resolution we need. The next thing, I mean, that is, the reason is that when you want to record blue light scatters when it hits a plate, and they will, by looking, making this hologram look like looking through a ground glass. You put a ground glass and an object behind it, how can you ever get a hologram? So that's why OpTIC Infod and all these Kodak material they had in the 60s until they all stopped making them towards the end of 1990s or even earlier. They were useless for holography. So we have to develop our own materials, and that of course makes it almost impossible to commercialize it as of today. Anyhow, we need three lasers minimum. You will see how many we really need. For like in any type of photography or amateur, you normally use the Maxwell's three-color theory, but holography use very narrow bandwidth lasers, so you will need more. And also the other thing that almost most projects in holography, many of them have failed because nobody knows how to light holograms properly, and they ignore that problem. So that is often a reason why a project failed. Also, of course, until we now have color, now even the display of them have become even more critical than before. Not only can you distort the image, but by not have the right angle, you distort the colors. So there has to be absolutely accurate installation of color holograms. Next slide, please. Here you can see the example of what happened when you use conventional, like an alpha paint, and try to make a color hologram. This is an object. This is an object with a pure gloss plate. This is one of the ultra-fine emulsions in front of the object illuminated with laser. And this is an alpha plate. So any person who tries to record a hologram and think they can use an alpha plate, the result will never be better than this. Next slide, please. And then we have run a project with a student that worked with the PhD student to develop color holography, and he was doing computer programs to simulate how many wavelengths you need to actually make a color hologram where the human eye really can't detect the difference from the real object and the holographic image of it. So here you can see that with three lasers, immediately when you go to four wavelengths, you get a dramatic decrease, and then it slowly increases when you come to around nine wavelengths. Next slide, please. And we look at up to seven wavelengths. That means that these are the wavelengths that it looks like this MAC system can't get the right dimension because the errors have disappeared out to the right. The screen looks not matching the I don't know, Mac people may know how you correct this, but nevertheless, it's these are the wavelengths for three lasers, the optimum, 4, 5, 6, and 7. Of course, we don't have these wavelengths in lasers easily available, so still we have problems to really develop color holography. Next slide, please. Here is what we did. This is a familiar Macbeth color target. This is the color target element with three lasers, and here is a color hologram of it. And what we did is account the error in each of these patches, how accurate they can be recorded. You can even see going from the real thing using now digital photography, which in itself is not working, to reproduce colors well. So then you go from this to the laser. So the laser will only see this, three lasers. And you can see here that the colors are not right. So what we did, we calculated each of them and see how well they can be reproduced theoretically. Next slide, please. Here you can see we have three lasers, and here are the errors on each of these patches. They vary depending on some of the wavelengths are better for this particular color, but worse for that, and so forth. And we try to get the average down to the minimum. Next slide, please. When we switch to four lasers, we have immediately got much better. So the error is down 0.02 now in color error as an average on all these patches. Next slide. And this is down now with five wavelengths. So there is a dramatic difference between going between three and four. So any serious application for museums will require four lasers for, and the four which I just showed you. Next slide. Here you can see the all on the same slide. So we go from three, four, and five. So four is really the, and then we'll see if we need to take it. It depends on the people in museum that come and say that this is not the, the real thing, it's a hologram. And if they say that, we have not reached the goal yet. Next slide. Here is how we do it now. We have three different lasers, a krypton for red. We have a CW neodymium YAG laser for the green frequency double, and an argon ion laser 476. And then we combine them with beam combiners that takes the red, send it through, and add the green, and add the blue, and send both of them. We have a shutter, and then we have the so-called Deniszuk setup. When I talk about Deniszuk, that may not be familiar to people not in holography, but Deniszuk was the person who invented holography in the former USSR, almost simultaneously as MFEs in the United States. He used what we call the single beam reflection holograms. And that technique is the most suitable for museums because that provides you with a 180 degree field of view in both dimensions, which is a requirement from museums. You don't want to have a box that you just have to stand in a particular position to see the object, and when you go away the object, and then of course you lose the illusion of having the object and if it's gone. So we only work with the Deniszuk technique. Next slide, please. Here is our lasers in OpTIC. These are the two, krypton and argon and the neodymium. Yeah. We send the beam. This is a laser room where we generate the light and combine it. Goes into another room, the beam. And there you see the white beam going into the recording room. This is from the laser into the recording room. Next slide, please. The reason why we have separate them is that the lasers are terrible noise sources with transformers. We don't want to have them at all present, nor on the table, nor in the room where we record holograms. That's a general rule in holography, but even more important when you work with color holograms. You may have an exposure time of 20 seconds or so, then you will create vibrations if you don't have an absolute silent area where you work. And here is that we have a huge table here, a very heavy table tilted on a German system to stabilize these two lasers so they are floating together in two different rooms. So an expensive system that works extremely well. Hologram alignment in a pinhole stays over weeks without getting misaligned, even when you work on two different tables. Next slide, please. Here is all the equipment we use to measure our holograms with this spectrophotometer here. So you can look at the hologram and measure the colors. Next slide, please. Now we come to the spotlight, which has been, as I saw, very important for color hologram, because when you make the hologram, you take the colors you want to achieve is the colors that your spotlight is going to emit. So you have to set the ratio between your lasers to mimic that. You can't take a color hologram that you have recorded that and take it out in the sun. Then they will completely bluish. So a hologram can only be made for a particular spotlight. And then they also have to have a specific angle, which is exactly the same angle as you used when you recorded it. The spotlight has to be provided, of course, you have no shrinkage in the emulsion. And of course, shrinkage is out in the color emulsion, because then you destroy the color. So our emulsions have absolutely no shrinkage. Next slide. Here is a common lamp that's similar to what we have now. This is a spectrum from that lamp. Mostly it emits in red. As you know, it's very little in blue. And the sun, of course, has much more in blue. So if you want to make a hologram that works in the sun, you have to adjust the three wavelengths so they will match that. Next slide. Then, of course, something has happened is new LED lights. They are extremely interesting because now if you get the right wavelengths as you use for recording, you can match that with an LED, and all the rest of the light is not even making the plate. So that would give you plates that are much higher contrast because you only illuminate it where the light is coming back. Or unfortunately, not yet, we have such plates that really work well. There is still a lot of work to be done, and also to combine these into a white good light LED, but we are working on it, and it soon we will have such lights that will be the perfect light source for color holograms. We can have see some of the advantages in the next slide. Long lifetime, I mean, you don't need to walk everywhere and change them. That's another problem with holograms on display. People ignore to switch the lights if they burn out. They are holograms in museums. They can be for a year without the light before they stay. Here at least you can guarantee that if you have a hologram on display, it will stay live all the time. Small size improve the sharper images as you have a better spatial filtering. They are very robust. Heat is generated, which is another source in a holographic museum. If you have a lot of light, it gets very hot and you need to have air conditioning. And also, there are only advantages if you can develop holographic LED lighting. Next slide, please. Here are some examples of our silver cross emulsion, which was done on a consortium in Europe to develop a suitable emulsion for color holography. The possibility of, there is some sources of that, and mainly from Russia. Russian holography has been well known for their superfine grain since the beginning. Then it really needed much higher resolution than needed to do it. So Russia has been the leader in that. But unfortunately, it's very difficult to buy any color material in Russia, as well as it is very difficult to find it anywhere else. Most people like me and Chantier, they don't really deliver emulsion to sell it to anybody. So that means that we have to make our own. But this consortium now was looking into, can we commercialize this emulsion? And that's the question. Next slide, please. So here you can see the object itself and the hologram of it. This is a spectrum with the same spotlight that we use to illuminate now the rare object. And here is with the, in this particular point. And there you can see what white is built up with. As of course, it's not identical. If we had a few more here, the difference between them would be less and less. But even now, it's very good. I have the holograms here, so you can look at them later. And this is the error in X and Y. This is the coordinates. This is the coordinates of the object, and this is the coordinates X, Y in the spectrum of the hologram on white. White is, of course, a very difficult to get perfect in a color hologram. Next slide. Here is another example I brought. I use this because it has a lot of blue. Blue is the most difficult color to record without scatter, and that's why we need nanometer, 10 nanometer grain size or so to record that. Our emulsion is in the order of 10 nanometer measured by electron microscopy. Next slide, please. Here again, you can see now that if we are looking in the blue part of the element, that we of course now have a stronger contribution here in the blue and less in red. You can also see something interesting here. The wavelengths we use are 647, 532, and 476, and they are identical, so there is absolutely no shrinkage in our plate before and after processing and recording. This is also a must for color holography. Next slide, please. And displaying, as I said, I can only see that holograms can be used with fixed installation. There is no way you can put a hologram on a journal or anything and think people will ever see a color hologram. So you have to have fixed installation in museums and so on. Wall-mounted hologram with overhead track lighting. And the track lighting should go in the opposite direction. They shouldn't go along the wall. They should have tracks going perpendicular to the wall for each hologram so you can adjust the angle by moving them back and forth. So museums need really to rearrange if they want to show holograms. There are these things with extended lights that you see here. That's okay for small, but if you think that you have a big hologram square meter and you want to extend it like 10 meters out, hanging out from the frame, it doesn't look aesthetically good. So these are things that one has to get away from. It has to be fixed installation with either integrated light in some way or in museums from the wall. As I showed in this museum long time ago, the best is to have them tilted 45 and overhead light and hide that light so nobody sees it. That's the most nice way of showing reflection holograms. Next slide, please. And then I want to just say something about potential application and color application. So this is just to show, of course, this is art education, I think, is one you can say. Every museum in the world, every art school in the world could have a fantastic collection of the most beautiful art pieces for students. They don't have to travel around the world to see them. They can have this library, they go and look at Mona Lisa, they go and look at any type of the old artifacts or whatever, paintings or the sculptures and so on. Next slide, please. Here is an example of cuneiforms I have done for a German museum. And cuneiforms need to be tilted to read the text, so photographs of cuneiforms are no good for the people who, that's why they really want color. Color may not be that important for this type of products or artifacts, but nevertheless. We go to the next slide, and now you can see the advantage of holography, because when you want to read this text, what you do, you hold it in your hand and you tilt them with the light moving across. So now any person that wanted to study these artifacts, they don't want to send them around to scientists, they want to send holograms of them, so of this type, so they can read the text and do their research. Next slide, please. This is another one I have brought here, and you can see I have all of these holograms that I show if you want to look at them as holograms. Next slide. This is another thing where you can think maybe for advertising also, that you don't need to have expensive stuff out in airports that cost a lot of interest to keep them, and safety issues. So why not just have holograms in these boxes? So can we animate it? You have to click on it again. So the important thing to see here is how the reflections really move across when you go around, as if they were actually inside that box. So this is one of the people that are really amazed when they see things like that. They can't believe that there is nothing behind the glass. Next slide. This is another example of a Russian egg, which is, again, you can see how this point that comes from the spotlight goes on the surface, as if that was how it was hit of the real object. So this really shows the advantage of holography. It's a dynamic image as well, full color. This was did on the Silver Cross Mansion for the National History Museum in London, and they were very pleased with this type of technique. So now museums are really interested in holography, but there is a long way to go, of course, before we will see that it can be commercialized. Next slide. Now I talk finally about the oil paintings. That may not be what you think of, because holography is 3D, but let's just show you what holography can do. Next slide. Here is an original oil painting, nothing particular, it's a very cheap one, but I use that because it was painted on wood and it has very marked strokes of the brush. So here is a holographic reproduction, only with 3 lasers. So of course the color reproduction is not perfect, but it's not that bad. Certainly as good as color photography. Next slide. But the advantage for the painters or the painting in interest is that you can go in the hologram and enlarge areas, so you can study in that hologram of the painting the paint strokes. Also things like this, which is in the original, of course you can find here in the hologram identical to that. The reason the color has changed here from there is not that the color is wrong, it's just to see these things you need to tilt the hologram so it goes out of the correct reference beam, which affect the color, but then you can see these defects. Or defects, it's just this particular. That of course will be a way to identify a stolen painting when it comes back. Is this the same painting that was stolen? So insurance company in the future may require, or certainly multi-million paintings should have a holographic reproduction in the insurance company if something happened. That can also be used to restore the damaged painting. Next slide. Here is one of my own collection of paintings from Peter van Gravel, 1629 to 1790. It's a holographic reproduction, and you can also see now how the light is showing the structure in the painting. This is on a canvas, and we can easily record that as well, just putting the holographic plate on top of the painting. Next slide, please. This is the final slide, or almost a final, but this is what we think holography will do. There is something that you will hear about later. I have now focused on the perfect, pure holographic technique. There are techniques where we can use computers and photography and combining to holography, which have a lot of interest. You will hear more about it from other speakers. I didn't talk about that because I am mainly interested in holography that can make images that are identical to the real world. And this computer and photography, since photography is integrated in the system, you can never get it because you have to go capture the light as coming from objects holographically to get something that is identical to the object itself. So the virtual image behind this type of a hologram is today the most realistic image we can get. And also the extensive field of view, about 180 degrees in both directions, makes it impossible to see that something is strange with the image. And the wavefront reconstruction process accurately represents only the light that has scattered off the object during the recording. That's why it's so important to have exactly the right wavelengths and enough of them to make that happen. And as far as I can see, it may happen during my lifetime, but definitely in 50 years' time, I can tell you that holography will be all over the world of this type of color holography. There is no doubt about it. And it's a pity that the photographic companies today are so, they have perfect equipment, but they don't look far enough. They get rid of beautiful coating systems, huge film coatings, because the only material that is silver halide, and also we will hear there are new materials coming out, very new photopolymers. So there are a lot of interest in the old type of silver photography emulsion techniques, and that will only expand over the coming years. So next slide, please. So as I said, people often ask me, can you send me a photo of your hologram? I say, why should I send that? It's useless. Why not? I can as well send you a photograph of the object itself. You already have it. The only way you can see it is to look at the hologram itself, and that's why for those who have never seen this hologram, I have brought all of them here that you have seen, so we can look at them in a break. Next slide, please. Okay, any questions? Yes?
Coherence lines. You talk about the need for different lasers, but I imagine if one of the lasers has a shorter coherence length than the rest, wouldn't the object shift color?
I mean, we need to have long coherence of all that, it goes without saying, also that a meter or more. Our green laser has kilometers of it. So I mean, don't worry about any objects that we talk about here with the size of plates we can create. You need to have at least the coherence to take the depths of this hologram. So the other thing, the lasers have to be absolutely stable output. If you set them up and record them, in the meantime, the red laser have changed. You can't get white anymore. New changes in the output from the three lasers will combine into the wrong color. So you have to have the best lasers in the world with stability point of view and coherence to do this. Yes?
I know that one of the main lines out of that are the lasers, 4 and 8. What's the percentage loss you have to put up with to make it come out at 4.76?
It is like half.
Half?
Yes, but the 488 is not a blue wine, it's a blue green, and it's not good for reproducing white. Yeah, I want to even go deeper, 440 or something, like you're hearing happening, but they have no output enough. There may become new solid state lasers in the future that will have better colors for color, but again, they are very hard to get them with the power we need. Yes? No. I mean, this is, of course, it's a very good question if you don't know it. The amount of laser light hitting them is nothing compared to, if you use a flash and take a photograph of an object, you probably emit more light to it than a laser. Lasers are emitted over a longer time during the recording, so we may have 20 seconds. If you take a flash photography in a millisecond, but even if you use pulse lasers, which can be used 20 nanosecond lasers, there is no risk, because if there was a risk, you will completely burn your emulsion, it will completely be destroyed when you send the light through it. So there is no risk to the object. The only thing you need to be aware of is, of course, you should test them if it is some very delicate textile that you could bleach by immediately if you emit. That could be the only thing I can think of. But a thing I come to mind is in the pyramids, they have paintings inside. They can't show it to people, only can switch on light on them occasionally. But if we could go in there and make color holograms of them, we can make another cave outside where all these holograms of the wall paintings are put up again, and they can be on day and night for years. Or because the advantage of a hologram, it doesn't have any pigment or any dyes in it. So it's a pure physical way of regenerating the light. So you can never bleach. I mean, there are things that could happen. That's more environmental thing. You need to see them and so on. But if you do that, they will survive hundreds of years with exactly the same color. The best example of that is Lippmann photography that I mentioned about Lippmann. I may have to stop now because we are late. So I think we can discuss more things in breaks and so. I think we have to stop questions because we are late with the program. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Hans. I'm now going to hand over to Graham Sachs, the well-known author and educationist.